Now we'll discuss the primitives provided by reliable virtual memory for the app developer. Recall what I said earlier, and that is, we do not want the in-memory data structures, when modified, to immediately start writing to the corresponding on-disk version in the external data segments, because that would result in a lot of random writes. And therefore, we suggested that what we want to do is use a log segment to aggregate changes that we are making to the portions of the virtual address space so that the log segment can then be committed to the disk to record the changes that we're making to the virtual memory. And so the first set of primitives that RVM provides is initialization. And in particular, this initialize primitive identifies the log segment to be used by the server process for recording changes to the persistent data structures of this process. And every process can declare its own log segment data structure for use in managing its persistence. So if I have a file system, it has its own data structures. Because remember that RVM is not inside the operating system, but RVM is provided as a runtime library in support of applications that live on top of the operating system. So the library provides these primitives, and so initialize is allowing the process that is using this library to declare a log segment data structure, which will be the data structure into which RVM, in the course of execution of the process, will aggregate changes that this process is making to persistent data structures so that later on, those changes in the log segment can be committed to the disk. And even further, those changes can eventually be reflected in the data segments that those in-memory versions of persistent data structures represent. The map primitive is the primitive that allows the application to say, what is the region of the virtual address space that I want mapped to an external data segment? I mentioned that there is a one-to-one correspondence between an address range in the virtual address space and the external data segments. So if I need to map different portions of the address space of the process to different data segments, I would execute multiple map calls to map different regions of my virtual address space to different external data segments. So this region descriptor contains both the address range that I want to be mapped, as well as it names the external data segment that corresponds to this particular address range. An unmap does the reverse, namely, it decouples the address range from the external data segment that it was associated with up until now. So in the body of the server code, these are the calls that an app developer would make. The begin transaction and end transaction alerts the RVM runtime that the application is about to make changes to persistent data structures between these begin and end transaction calls to the RVM library. End, in fact, signals to the RVM library that the transaction has committed, meaning that all the changes that the application made in between begin and end to data structures that are persistent have to be flushed to the disk. That is, they have to be made persistent. On the other hand, a begin transaction could also end in an abort transaction, which essentially signals to the RVM library that all the changes that the application made bound between begin transaction and abort transaction have to be thrown away by the RVM library and should not be committed to the disk. That is, they should not be persisted. So the idea then is between begin transaction and end transaction, the application developer is modifying the in-memory version of the persistent data structures and committing them to the persistent storage by calling this end transaction, which is saying, commit my changes to the in-memory versions to the persistent version on the disk. On the other hand, if the developer calls an abort transaction after a begin transaction, then all the changes that he or she made to persistent data structures should be thrown away by the RVM library and not persisted on the disk. The setRange call is the very first thing that an app developer would do inside a begin transaction, end transaction sequence. You can think of this code between begin transaction and end transaction like a critical section of the app developer's code base. And the first thing that happens within that critical section is a call to set range. What the set range is saying is, even though an address region may be mapped to an external data segment, in this particular critical section, bound by begin and end transaction, I'm going to modify only a portion of that address range. And that portion of the address range that I'm going to modify is specified by the starting address and the size of that block that I'm going to modify. That's the purpose of the set range call, which says, for this particular transaction, which is started here, for which RVM will return a unique transaction ID to me when I make this call, I'm going to use this transaction ID and tell RVM that for this particular transaction, I'm going to modify only a block of memory starting at this address and bound by this address. That's the purpose of the set range call. So it is only this portion of it that we're going to modify. And we will see how all of what I said is used by the RVM library in its implementation in a minute. But from the user's point of view, from the developer's point of view, this is all that the developer needs to know and use in order to write his application that has persistent data structures. As simple as that. All the heavy lifting that is needed to accomplish the developer's intent for persistence that are enshrined in these primitives is taken care of by the RVM runtime, which we will see in a minute.